Ho, and welcome to the QI Christmas Party! So, now, joining me for warm white wine in the canteen this evening are the skinny geezer from accounts, Rich Hall! The scary woman from human resources, Jo Brand! The big guy from marketing with the goatee, Dara O'Brien. And, of course, the acting deputy director of humorous content transmission, South East Region, Alan Gagmeister Davis. Let's hear, if we may, those seasonal bells. Joe goes... Dara goes...
Sleigh bells jingling, ring, 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 too.
Rich goes... And Alan goes...
Ring-a-ding, 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 ring-a-ring, ring, ring-a-ding. Ring-a-ding, 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 ring-a-ring, ring, ring-a-ding.
Now, more than £20 billion gets spent in the UK each Christmas, and a third of all books, clothes and toys are sold in the last 8 weeks of the year. 150 million Christmas cards get sent, 7.5 million trees are decorated, and we buy enough wrapping paper to gift wrap Guernsey. So, let's just take a few moments then together and try to remember, why is Christmas Day on December the 25th?
Ring, ring, ring-a-ding.
Oh. It's the birth of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Wallamy, wallamy, woo.
Well, that's all we get it out of the way.
Yes.
Is that a very, very small fire or are those huge stars?
It's a midwinter solstice. It's a pagan festival that's been appropriated by Christianity.
There is a great deal of truth in that.
Do I get the points back?
You will certainly get some back. It was indeed, there's a Teutonic, Celtic and pagan view that if you've survived the winter solstice on the 21st of December, you have a feast to celebrate. But also, there was the Roman god.
Was it Saturnalia?
There was the Saturnalia, was also at that time of year, but there was Mithras.
Just the two of them were there?
Well... There are amazing things claimed about Mithras, and I'll read you some of them. He was a saviour, Mithras, sent to Earth to live as a mortal, through whom it was possible for sinners to be reborn into immortal life. He died for our sins, but came back to life the following Sunday. He was born of a virgin on December the 25th in a manger, or perhaps a cave, attended by shepherds, and became known as the Light of the World. He had 12 disciples with whom he shared a last meal before dying. His devotees symbolically consumed the flesh and blood of him. Because Mithras was a sun god, he was worshipped on Sundays.
Is he a tribute band?
He's often depicted with a halo around his head. Oh. And Mithraists gave each other gifts on December the 25th. The leader of the religion was called a papa, and their HQ was on Vatican Hill in Rome.
And you're kind of writing off the chance that this was just a massive coincidence. And then one day they all went to the Vatican and went, what? Ah, hang on.
Well, a lot of Christian scholars have since been very angry at some of this research which came out in 1903 about Mithras, and they claim it's nonsense.
There's a few flaws, though, aren't there? I mean, I've never heard a bloke go, oh, Mithras, when he's coming. Have you?
No, you're right. I'm not sure that Christians would point to that as somehow a vindication of their religion. It's certainly true that there are dozens of religions in world mythology that have had visits by wise men, kings who've killed children to stop the new king being born. There's a great deal in Christianity that is traditional. And however wonderful people think the story is, it's frankly not original.
This is an interesting direction to start your Christmas special with.
There was the Yule Festival, which was a very...
Where we get the log from.
The Yule log.
And you'll be coming home in an ambulance.
Yay!
Thank you.
Yule Brynner.
Yule Brynner.
You're lovely, you are.
The nativity story in the Bible. Probably because they couldn't find a hotel room they hadn't booked in advance.
They should have known it would be busy. Yeah. Because it's Christmas.
Exactly.
Does it explain, by the way, why Christmas is so very definite in the date, that the, you know, 25th, bang, every year, same week, whereas Easter is a random pin in a map?
All these things were decided 300, 400, 500, 600 years after Christ. They had conferences and they decided that Christmas should be the 25th of December because there were thousands of people already celebrated on that date because that was Mithras Day.
Yeah, and they stuck All Saints Day and All Souls Day around by the time that people were celebrating.
I don't think there's an Arsehole's Day.
You're in your liberal agenda.
Yes. That's November the 1st, I believe.
Yes, it is.
All Hallows.
Yes, exactly. But they're just tying into, you know, old pagan rituals of, you know, the dead rising.
Isn't it odd that Jesus' resurrection that day is arbitrary, but British bankers always know what day they're going to get off.
Right. You don't call them bank holidays.
Every day's a bank holiday in America.
Washington's birthday, is that a holiday? No, that's
just... lumped in with Lincoln and Elvis.
Right. Fair enough. The memorial memorializes what?
Dead guys.
Anyway, the 25th of December is the birthday of Mithras, the popular Roman sun god. The date was borrowed for Jesus, whose birthday is unknown and not mentioned in the Bible. And according to Islam, Jesus, who is a prophet in the Quran, of course, was born in the summer. And according to Jehovah's Witnesses, he was born on the 1st of October.
Well, they saw it, presumably.
Yes. Yeah.
They were Jehovah's Witnesses, you know. Of all people. By the way, can we just not completely lose the facade that we're doing the Christmas special?
Right. Absolutely. Now, about Christmases, what does the Queen do after Christmas lunch?
As a does during the Queen's speech.
Do they?
They go for a walk. They go to church.
Oh, hello. No, they go to church in the morning, definitely, St. Mary Magdalene in Sandringham. But they've furnished us with remarkable details, I have to say, the royal family.
Does that mean that somebody from the office is going to be tuning in to see how these details were handled?
Yes.
And I'd like to be thrilled at the sensitive way in which the Queen's Christmas Day has been described.
So far. I've been wriggling slightly. But just to get it out of the way, the answer is she goes into the saloon and watches herself on television. On Christmas Eve, right, they gather in the white drawing room at Sandringham around a 20-foot Christmas tree cut from the Sandringham estate. And I want to add here, at the risk of being booed, that I get my tree from the Sandringham estate. It's decorated by the Queen herself.
Well, your tree.
Actually, no.
Does she come round to do it? I bet you send her out in the garden. No, do it out in the garden.
At 5 p.m, the whole family has a cup of Earl Grey, except the Queen, who has her own Indian blend.
Is it Twinings?
I hope so. This is turning into a massive embarrassment all round. they have sandwiches, cakes and scones. At 6 p.m, they open presents. This is Christmas Eve, remember. Why do they open presents on Christmas Eve?
Because they're all f***ing mad.
No, because they're all f***ing German. It's a German tradition. And there you are. The Queen gives the signal. They give each other practical presents, it turns out. The Queen is said to have been delighted...
With a gun. With a gun.
Oh, that's bloody brilliant!
No. With a casserole dish and a gift-wrapped washing-up apron.
It's one of those ones with tits on the front.
After dinner, after Christmas Eve dinner, the Queen and the other female royals leave the room with the corgis. Prince Philip then serves port... Prince Philip then serves port or brandy to the male members of the royal family.
Oh, for God's sake.
Right. Well, that's tradition. That's tradition.
They're now wearing only loincloth.
Exactly. If I told you this about an Aboriginal tribe, you'd say, oh, how interesting.
So no,
it's
just
it's tribal behaviour, that's all. It's interesting, I think. They get stockings on Christmas morning.
Prince Philip gets stockings. No. Like serving the brandy.
No, no, this is next morning. They all have at the foot of their bed.
He wears them all night.
The family pulls crackers, but the Queen refuses to wear her paper party hat. And then at 3 p.m, they go to the saloon to watch me on Christmas Day. We love them all and we wish them well at this Christmas time. And talking of dysfunction at the Christmas time, what suffers most at the office Christmas party?
I have to say, this is the photocopier from having so many asses on it.
It's the right answer! Yep.
Hey.
I was going to say, that was a long photo shoot for me, that was.
There is a 25% increase in emergency call-outs around the 2 weeks leading up to Christmas. And Canon, they've done a survey about this, and it's absolutely astonishing how much people abuse their photocopies at Christmas parties. It's not just a myth, people really do it.
Has the Queen got a photocopy?
She uses a portrait artist whenever she needs anything duplicated. I want this page painted in half an hour. Two copies, A4. And, they rather splendidly named Canon engineer Jeff Bush. Says that he's had glass broken due to young ladies copying their rears. They've found sleeping cats inside the copiers, a snake, a kitchen knife, a sausage roll, a condom, stockings, a vibrator, and even a cheque for £6,000.
Why the hell put the cat in? I can understand.
A copycat.
Yay! Maybe they lifted it up because there was a paper jam because somebody...
Go in there, Tiddles, and clear that up, here. These little paws would get at the toner faster. Like, and get to reach and tug
it. It is a peculiar thing to find. A snake is odder in a way, because...
But maybe, do they send in the snake to clear out the cat? Is this a...
Technically, though, I think you can fax a snake.
merriness at Christmas. Tell me about champagne. Who invented it?
The French. In the Champagne region.
No. No, they didn't. The Belgian... grape came from Champagne, the Champagne region.
Are they Belgian?
They were not the ones
Belgians.
Who invented
it. Belgian monks?
Germans?
No.
English?
Yes, English.
Champagne!
Just got that word.
Yep. It was by accident because there was something wrong with the bottle and the wine went fizzy and they liked it.
No, this was the myth that the French put out in the 19th century about Dom Perignon. Oh. They claimed that by accident it went fizzy and he said, come in, everybody, I'm drinking the stars. And it's all absolute bollocks. It was the 16th century the British started importing this green flat wine from the Champagne region and they added sugar and molasses to make it sparkle. Anyone makes ginger beer, it goes very fizzy. It's culture, you know.
I'm sorry, who among this table has ever made ginger beer?
Haven't you? Yes, thank you. A surprising ally. And it multiplies, doesn't it? You can't get rid of the stuff. It's a culture, like yogurt. So when
they should have a ginger beer episode on Doctor Who, because it takes
they're
over
like aliens.
The planet. I made vodka as well.
Moscow mules.
Yes, ginger beer and vodka. You could have made your own Moscow mules.
Oh, bollocks.
That's a fine drink. Anyway, it's three times more pressure than in a car tyre inside a bottle of champagne. So you need a very strong glass, and the British had the technology by that time, 16th, 17th century we're getting to. And we had quite good corks, but Dom Perignon invented the wire cage to go over the cork, and he also did the blending. Do you drink it?
No, Guinness.
Do you drink it?
A Guinness? No. I've served it a few times, know how to pull it correctly, which is a piece of information that hasn't transferred over here at all. You have to let it sit, you have to let it go black, and then you have to push it back so no more gas goes into it. 5/12 of an inch is the ideal head around the top. And if somebody paints a shamrock into it, you're allowed to stab them in the eye with a fork. I remember working in a pub in the town I grew up in, and it was a very tough pub. They wouldn't take a Guinness off me until I'd been there for a while.
Really?
Yeah.
He doesn't know how to do it.
Well, the pub I was in... the pub I was in actually wasn't located in a movie from the 50s, but...
The bugs and the little people.
No, there wasn't.
It's not so.
No, surprising. I had to work just outside the land of the bars. You could look over the wall in the from where we were into where the tiny people pranced and danced.
So, now, while we're on the continent, which figure is essential to the Christmas crib in Catalonia?
Is it Barry Norman?
One of those wild stabs in the dark, and I would so love to say, how amazing, you're right, but you're not.
Is it a figure that we don't get in ours?
It's a figure we don't get in our cribs. In the back of a Catalonian crib, there is always a man squatting and defecating, or a young boy, and very often a public figure.
In the middle, by the manger, with
it's
baby
weird,
Jesus.
But it's true.
It could be Barry Norman.
It could be Barry Norman. It's so unlikely. They've had George W. Bush and they've had David Beckham. They have the crapper. He's called the cagane. Caga is crap in Catalonian, as it is in many other languages.
Every crib has to have a guy
crapping. A true Catalonian crib will. Yeah, I know you're thinking I'm making this up. They are a very scatological people, the Catalonians. They call their Christmas log the cagatio, the shit log. And there's a popular Catalan phrase. Before eating, they say, menjabe, caga fort. Eat well, shit hard.
You've got the Catalan colours.
I'm wearing Catalan colours, aren't I? But I'm not squirting out turds as I speak.
Shit hard, fry. Shit hard.
Caga fort. Anyway, next question. Who got little leather boots for Christmas in Norfolk?
Yes. The Norfolk Gimp.
What do we say in Norfolk Christmas-wise, yes?
Bernard Matthews' turkeys.
Well, not his. Turkeys in Norfolk have a long, long history, well before Mr. Matthews. We're going all the way back to the 16th century, the 1500s.
Don't show them wandering around as if that's how they live.
That's how they did. They drove them. That's the point. They drove them.
They don't now. They live
no,
in
I'm
vast
talking about
aircraft hangers, pecking each other to death.
They now live...
Zapping under their vast, bulbous, antibiotic-filled bodies.
Sounds a bit like my house.
Yes. But in the past, they were taken from Norwich to London every year for Christmas time, because the British habit of eating turkey for Christmas was as early as Queen Elizabeth's reign. Although they were first brought to Europe in 1520, by 1580s, Norfolk and Suffolk farmers were droving thousands of them every year. We bred our own turkeys in Norfolk, the Norfolk Black and the Holland White. Those turkeys were put on the Mayflower, and when the Pilgrim Fathers arrived in America, they ate turkeys that had been bred in England. They didn't catch turkeys on the coast of America. But because their feet would go, ooh, awful, you know. So they gave them little boots. And they do the same with geese. You can't shoe a goose, it's an old phrase. So they cover them in tar and sand so they could walk without hurting themselves. And pigs would have little woolen boots with leather soles for the pig.
Nice.
March them
it's
along.
It's nice, except they're marching to their own death.
Well, they I can't are. See Would you rather that or have
them
in Auschwitz?
I'm not saying that this wasn't a better way to deal with them, but I just wouldn't get too excited about how happy they should be to have their little present of a shoe.
It's sweet.
Shoes! Where are we going? Were they online looking at, visitlondon.com? Oh, I can't wait to see that. Oh, I think I might go in the eye.
Yeah, I might. Well, I think they did a mile a day and they had a lovely time. Wow. Compared to the ones now, which, as you say, live in these ghastly concentration camps. Why are they called turkeys?
Because they're from Turkey.
Do you think they're from Turkey? Is that where
No.
I'm... No. No, the first merchants to sell them on in Europe were Turkish, yeah. So they were known as turkey cocks. But the weird thing is everyone else calls them Indian. The French call it Dand, which is from and the Indies. The Polish call it Indic. The Dutch call it kalkoen, the Calcutta hen. The Austrians call it an Indian. The Turks call it a Hindi. In Hindi, they call it a Peru Pakshi, a Peru bird. But the great original in America, its land of origin, is fuck it. In Choctaw.
Oh, right.
And they've now changed it to a Kankchaha, tall chicken, to avoid embarrassment. Anyway, that brings us caroling into the mad hurly-burly of general ignorance. So fingers on bell buzzers, and appropriately for the season, all these will have a sacred theme. Now, name a saint who comes from Ireland.
Patrick.
Oh!
Bother.
He went to Ireland, but he didn't come.
None of the patron saints of Britain are from where they're supposed to be from, are they?
George is Palestinian, St. George.
Yes.
Patrick is Welsh.
British, certainly. Came from around the River Severn area, apparently.
St. Bernard was from a shelter.
But you must be able to name some genuine...
Yes, St. Columbkill, St. Bridget, St. Kevin.
St. Bridget. Do you know what her great miracle was?
She laid down a cape, because she said, I want some land to build a convent. She said, well, you can have whatever land your cape covers. And she laid it down, and the cape grew like ginger beer in every direction. And taken over the entire field.
That is one of her great miracles. The other one was that she could transform her used bathwater into beer. The Irish
that
sort
one,
of miracle.
That one wasn't taught to us in primary school in Ireland.
Kevin?
Kevin lived halfway up a mountain in Glendalough in Wicklow and was like an Irish Francis of Assisi. Small animals would nest in his hand, and rather than crush the fecker and get on with his day, he would let the bird rest there and heal or whatever. Brilliant. And he'd go, please, I've got stuff to do. Do you want to bring up any more of these scars of my childhood right here?
It is astonishing to imagine an education like that.
I will say this for it. Like, I do remember once going out with a lady who was raised atheist and an utter chore to walk around a gallery with. They go, who's the guy on the sticks? Is he the same guy who was in the shed earlier on?
Who is St. Bartholomew? Because I went in a museum in Venice and there was a painting of him, and he's a spit of me. I was a spit of him. Anyway, it was a virtually full-size picture, and it was uncanny and a little bit frightening because he was only wearing a nappy and he'd been shot with an arrow.
His day is the 24th of August. I know that. That's St. Bartholomew's Day. And there's obviously a famous hospital in London, St. Bartholomew's.
But he's probably the reason why they say always wear clean underwear if in case you're in an accident, because he had to go to A&E with an arrow and a nappy on and to sit in the waiting
so
room.
So long, they named the hospital.
After him, exactly. Lord, there you are.
A lot of them had arrows. St. Sebastian was a famous one to be shot with arrows.
But well, maybe it was St. Sebastian. Maybe it wasn't St.
There is a Mantegna St. Sebastian that does look not unlike you, it has to be said.
Do you know what? I think it might be St. Sebastian.
I think it was St. Sebastian. St. Bartholomew's death was that he was flayed alive, and most paintings of St. Bartholomew have him with his skin draped over his arm, his own skin.
No, that wasn't him.
That wasn't him.
So I've seen that statue in church. I always used to think when I was a kid that he just had a sort of beige-coloured coat.
His own skin. Anyway, the patron saint of Ireland went to Ireland but didn't come from there. He was kidnapped as a child, sold into slavery to Ireland. And then when he went onto the continent, became a monk, he wanted to come back to Ireland to convert it to Christianity and cast out snakes. But who painted this behind me, talking of Italian art?
Oh, no, you're not going to get me now.
Shall I have a go?
Have a go, my dear.
Was it Jackson Pollock? Michelangelo.
No.
The fingers are wrong, Did he not do the fingers?
We could show it wider. It's the creation of Adam, there it is.
I've got it on my phone, and you know what? You're not supposed to take pictures, but I took one like that. There's a bloke at the back going, no pictures! No pictures!
Sebastiano!
Oh, tell him. Yo! In the nappy!
The Sistine Chapel is what we're looking at, of course, and he painted it round about 1511, Michelangelo. Only about 40 years later, God and Adam's fingers fell off. So the new plaster was put in, and an unknown papal restorer actually painted them. So those bits are not by Michelangelo.
Like that.
It is one of them.
God and Adam. It is one of the... for a laugh. Is that the undercoat? It's the undercoat. I'm having a laugh.
Very good. So, talking of great holy figures, when did Father Christmas die?
Oh, come on. He's not dead, he's still alive.
Well, I know he's dead.
I hope all the children are in bed.
It's all right.
There are going to be some tears now.
We're talking about the Father Christmas, who we know is dead because we've seen his entry in the Register of the Dead in the church where he lived and grew up in Dedham in Essex. We've actually seen him. He was an old man called Christmas. It was his surname, Father Christmas. There it's written, I hope you can see it there.
And I knew this... a girl from Essex called Laura Christmas.
Exactly. Christmas is a common surname in Essex. So this poor Father Christmas here died on May the 30th, 1564. There was a Roger Christmas of Sussex in 1200, the earliest Christmas found in British records. There's still about 1,000 people in the phone books called Christmas in Essex, Surrey, Cambridge, London and Sussex.
I remember when I was a kid, there was someone in the phone book called Mr. Bastard, right?
Yes.
And we used to phone him up and go, hello, is Dave there, please? And he'd go, there isn't anyone here called Dave. And we go, oh, must be some other bastard there. Surely you could come up with a good Christmas one to do.
Well, they used to ring up Jesus College. He would call it up on Christmas Day and say, is that Jesus? And the porter would go, yes. Happy birthday. Really annoying for them. Very silly. But anyway, it was an old English habit to call people Father if you didn't know their name and they were an old man, like Father Smith and Father William, and he was known as Father Christmas, and that's how he's written in the book. And it was before, of course, Santa Claus was known as Father Christmas, so it didn't obviously seem like a joke to them. It
would have been great if his wife had been named Mary.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Very good. Lovely, lovely, lovely. There you are. Do you know where Santa Claus came from, by the way?
Was it a German thing or is
not
it?
Not German, no, where's St. Nicholas, the saint?
Russia.
Nope.
Catalonia, and he's actually having a job there.
You've been a bad child this year. No, it's not.
Turkey.
A... Turkey is the right answer. Yeah. He was a Turkish saint. And on that happy note, ladies and gentlemen, it's time to go home. So let's see what's in your party bag, shall we? Oh, my goodness me, it's champagne for Dara with 2 points. And it's Spanish brandy for Rich with -9.
And I'm clapping.
It's cooking sherry.
I have -9, and they're applauding.
And it's cooking sherry for Joe Brand with -17. And with -53, it's a. It's a can of special brew and a train home for Alan Davis! My very special spicy mulled thanks to Rich, Dara, Joe and Alan, and I leave you with this seasonal mince pie from the great black American comic Dick Gregory. I never believed in Santa Claus because I knew no white dude would come into my neighbourhood after dark.
Next week, a Christmas ghost story. Greg Wise stars in an adaptation of a story by M.R. James, the master of chill. That's here on BBC4, Friday night, 10:30.